Research Centre for Environmental Humanities, which may not be a concept that you encountered before. It's a rather new coinage for a field of research that is very richly interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary, in that we look to work with communities as well as with other scholars and with artists. And our project, really, and I've got this from our website, because we spent ages working out what it was that we did, and we finally came up with a formula, so I'm going to share it with you. This is the first time I've tried to say this publicly. So let's see what happens. So it's something along these lines, that the Environment Humanities, or at least our research centre, explores how humanities scholars, artists, performers, writers, and scientists, both natural sciences scientists and social scientists, can work with each other and with communities beyond academia to produce ethical, creative, historically informed, and culturally sensitive responses to environmental problems. So it's really looking at the interrelationship between culture and environment, particularly looking at the big social and ecological challenges that we face today, such as rampant biodiversity loss, climate change, or forms of pollution, and so on, and to think, how does culture play into that? What are the cultural drivers of these destructive behaviours, and what cultural resources do we have for addressing them? That's really what we're looking at. And so I'm really thrilled that I've been able to invite two of my colleagues from BASPA, and Tiago, an independent performer, to present this forum today. So how it's going to run is that they're each going to talk, and for about some 20 minutes, half an hour or so, and then we're going to have a break for drinks, because the bar is here, is going to open at 6:30, and then I'm going to try and get you all back in here so we can have a wider discussion. So it's talks, drinks, discussion, roughly. Couple of things. First of all, the event is being filmed. So if you would prefer, basically it's the speakers who are going to be filmed, but if you wanted to contribute to the discussion but would prefer not to be on the film, please do let Owen know. This is my colleague Owen Jones, who's a fellow professor of environmental humanities and doing some filming for us. Let him know and we can edit that out from, and also Maggie Swallow is also filming. So it's Owen and Maggie, if you would like to request that your contribution to the discussion doesn't go public, so that we can feel free to say whatever we want to say and be as outrageous as we like and swear and curse and tear our hair out. And if you don't want that to go public, we won't go public with it. So that's the first thing, just going to film. The second thing is, could you please turn off your mobile phones or put them on silent? Have I done that? Yes, I have. Very good. Okay, our first speaker is Thomas Kumper. Thomas is on the steering group of the Research Centre, representing the performing arts. He's very valued colleague, and a senior lecturer, not least because I'm actually, I'm a Germanist by training, so it's so nice to have somebody at the university with whom I can speak German.
You are. Asian.
So Thomas is senior lecturer for movement on the BA acting at Basque University, and he's worked with dance, theatre, embodiment and sight interventions for the last 30 years. As performer, choreographer, director, and educator, and you can read more about him on the website. But Thomas is really going to give something of a kind of an overview and an introduction to this space of eco-somatic art practice and eco-political performance as well. So thank you so much, Thomas. Over to you.
Thank you so much for inviting me. Thank you so much for being here. So I won't say much about myself. I'll start with this. First slide, so I'm going to talk about something that I call somatic activism. Obviously, I'll also talk about what that might mean, somatics. And a project, an emerging project, is called Ecosomatics, that's been emerging over the last 20 years. And I'll look at some case studies of works by peers who are performers, visual artists, mixed media artists, who've got ecological concerns and are trying to kind of find a way of coping with crisis and coping with the environment and what does it mean to be a human being in this changing world. I'll talk also a little bit about a few projects, I'll whiz through them, of practices that I've been engaged in over the last 20 years or so. And I'll talk about a series of workshops that I undertook with an organization in Sicily called Siculata. And out of those site responsive somatic workshops, a dance collective, Dance Attack, emerged, who did urban intervention against capitalism and consumerism and pollution, which is very interesting. And with these people, I've worked on a project called Punti di Fuga in Germany, which was a project with people with refugee backgrounds from Syria, Asia, and from Iraq, on doing kind of site-responsive work on homing, on arriving home. And I'll also look a little bit at how that work was then represented in Germany in a particular public site. So, I have to click this way, my little clicker. Oh no, I've clicked wrong. So the bigger project, perhaps, or the bigger context, which I've been just discovering that it is a bigger context, teaching movement and teaching embodiment, I feel I'm always teaching something that is against disembodiment. And our colleague Sean Sullivan from the Environmental Humanities and an Australian eco-philosopher Aaron Garr talked about the current age, or the coming age perhaps, as an age of that age must be an age of re-embodiments, because the grand master narrative, that what brings modernism and postmodernity together, is the concept of disembodiment as a destruction of the soulful self, of the soulful embodied self, of the enchanted soulful living environment, as a master narrative that logically results in consistent ecocides and genocides. So we're living in a culture that has a trajectory of disembodiment running through it. That's what they're saying. So in a way, re-embodiment as a culture against separating the, and postulating the body as object, and perhaps looking at strategies developed by artists such as rewilding, or what my colleague Helen Spackman called practices of bewilderment as artistic practices. So if we talk about ecosomatics as a field, we have to talk a little bit about what somatics might be. Somatics is a field that emerges from early 20th century European body cultures, predominantly emancipatory proto-feminist body cultures, that were concerned again with anti-civilizatory re-embodiment. That through kind of Jewish diaspora and modern dance diaspora was brought into America after the Second World War, and this guy called Thomas Hanna began in the 1970s to try to articulate this culture of embodiment as a field, the field of somatics. The field of somatics is a field which studies the soma. The soma understood as the body perceived from within through first-person experience. So not an objectified body, not a correct body, but a body perceived from within. And it's concerned with the inner relational processes between awareness, biological function, and the environment, understood as a synergetic whole. Now, I'll say this straight away, he was very much influenced by a practitioner called Moshe Feldenkrais. And this is literally Feldenkraisian wording, a functional unity between body, mind, and environment that constructs the self. He wrote a book in 1970 at the height of kind of hippiedom, where we're all coming from. Some of us don't have hair, I think. Bodies in Revolt, and he talks about somatic culture, urging us to construct a culture which encourages sensing, encouraging the kind of sensory perception that is not primarily environmentally oriented, but a sensory perception that is proprioceptive self-sensing, a culture towards self-sensing. And that's the main apparatus, if you wish, the main strategy in somatic is to return to your inward looking, to self-perception. So he was very much influenced by the work of Moshe Feldenkrais. I'm a Feldenkrais practitioner. I teach Feldenkrais informed practices. Moshe Feldenkrais was a leading somatic practitioner, Jewish, developed his work in Europe and in Israel, was an engineer, nuclear physicist, a judo black belt, and he developed several practices. One of them, this is me teaching somewhere in the back, a practice called Awareness Through Movement, ATM, where the teacher instructs and questions, asks a series of questions to encourage inquiry, to encourage curiosity, to encourage increased self-perception, a group class. As we can see, these people are not standing, they're lying down. It's not about seeing something on the horizon or being seen. It's not a spectacular culture. It's a return to just being in my life. It's like a Freudian couch here that we're lying on, but we're looking inwards. There's a second process called functional integration, which is a touch-based dialogue between the practitioner and the learner through attunement processes. So we're really learning to listen to another preacher through touch, and we're looking at what perhaps the ecologist Edgar Morin called the process of self-eco-reorganization, how a person is constantly in self-organization in relationship to other, in relationship to the environment. So Feldenkrais' work is really about corporeal processes of reimagining and re-embodying the colonized self, or the repressed self, or the restricted self. We're looking at developing awareness and finding ways of discovering new patterns in ourselves through processes that Elizabeth Berger called processes of self-imaging. Feldenkrais adopts Schilder's concept of the self-image or body image, that self-image that governs our activities and our actions and our ways of being is not a thing. That self-image is a process. We're constantly imagining ourselves. We constantly are under self-construction. Feldenkrais came up with this concept of organic learning in opposition to academic learning. Organic learning, Feldenkrais practitioner Mark Rees said, organic learning is related to the physical development of the body and nervous system, strange kind of way of saying this, as codependent interaction with the outer world. We're always enacting and embodying and unworlding ourselves in dialogues. Feldenkrais talked about posture as an evolutionary necessity concerned with self-preservation, self-reproduction, self-maintenance. So he had an eco-somatic perspective on body culture already. And we're using an enactivist approach to imagery predominantly. We're constructing new ways of perceiving and sensing ourselves through movement, through enacting something, through interacting with touch, the environment. We're using movement and touch to create new sensation in ourselves, which give us new possibilities of interacting with the world. Now, Feldenkrais was very much concerned with transcending dualism, of course, body-mind divide, and he constructs a practice that encourages embodied and affective thinking. He says, in my lessons, the student learns to act while he thinks and thinks while he acts. We're trying to kind of create these kind of connectivities so that also thought can be connected to feeling. He talks about thought that is not connected to feeling at all, is not connected to reality. We are affected sentient beings. And in his lessons he talks about, I'm interested in constructing conditions where students can learn to think, but not to think with words, but in a Batesonian way, with patterns, with images, patterns, and connections. That sort of thinking, he says, always leads to a new way of action. I call this a choreographic way of thinking, with patterns, images, and through the body. He also has a decentered self at the heart of his thinking. that the person is a functional unity between body, mind, and environment. We're part of a bigger ecosystem, and that ecosystem is part of us, and we're part of that. The human environment, he says, involves the self-image, as well as the sexual, social, cultural, besides the spatial and temporal aspects of it. We're socially eco-social beings, desiring political change. And it's a radical project. Already in the 1950s, he was talking about projects of deconditioning, concerned with the liberation of this, of in which we develop a self-active part, a process of self-activation in the learner. This is the most difficult thing for me, or the most joyful thing also for me as a pedagogue with the students. Am I teaching movement for actors? Not really. Yeah? I'm self-activating, disembodied, British, white, absent people who are absent in their, they're absent, they're colonialized. They are functional robots, my young students. They're 18-year-old absences. And we're trying to reactivate them again to liberate them from their subjective enslavement. So it's part of what the philosopher Cornelius Castoriadis called the project of autonomy in the 20th century. The idea of democracy, modern democracy, being the project of autonomy. Feldenkrais talked about looking for a society of men and women, men with greater awareness of themselves as a base for change. So I'm really interested in the field of critical somatics, aiming to investigate, construct these practices and articulate them as practices of empowerment in order to look at how they can maybe lead to social change. And I'm not alone in that. There's a whole field of that which we could call somatic activism now developing. I ran a symposium and been editing a journal volume called Bodily Undoing, which assembled a lot of people in a lot of arenas and areas of people who are interested in these kind of activisms, eco-somatics, social somatics, or somatics and social justice, as the Institute for Somatics and Social Justice. How do we apply these embodiment practices in the world in critical ways in order to facilitate social transformation, cultural transformation? So eco-somatics kind of emerged from the dance and somatics nexus. Dance, modern dance, postmodern dance has been long connected to somatics. There's some United States influence, Andrea Olson, Brandon Hose, the place called Earth Dance in the United States. They ran a festival on somatic experiments, Earth Dance and Science, 2008. Certainly the work of Anna Halprin with her planetary dances and circle, the Earth Dances. There's a place called Moving On Center that developed a process called Live Art Processes. Coming out of that, of course, this also all links to the work of Josef Beuys and the visual art kind of connectivities. I'm not talking about that at all. But we have a teacher at Bath Spa who works with the Shin Somatics of Sandra Frawley. And very, very important work is the work of Practical Surya Dharmor, Amerta movement coming from Java. So it's not all white middle class people doing this, but there's also a kind of different culture. That he was very much concerned with eco-somatics when people like Helen Poyner or Sandra Reeve in the UK are practitioners of that kind of process and taking it further in the UK. Just an example of how academia is concerned with this. There's a journal coming out, Choreographic Practice, with a volume on performing ecologies in the world of crisis. So there are people caring about. There are people investigating of how do we get out of that that vanity project of studying acting or the old Vic or the vanity project of being in a dance studio. How do we create meaning? How do we create a critical culture in what we're doing? Who cares about another piece of dance? Really? No one. Who cares about that dance acting studio? No one. I don't. So eco-somatics, Sylvie Fontaine, who is a leading critical somatic practitioner, talks about eco-somatic is about awareness of both of our internal milieu and our external milieu and the reciprocal action between the two in relation to the
encountered, if there even is a difference, of course, with the skin that separates us from the rest of the world, including the belief that our body and planet are shared the same living process, that the most basic stuff we need, water, oxygen, and air, and everything else. She talks about paths to somatic awareness. She talks about, well, perhaps an increase in, of internal organic awareness, this increased somatic awareness might lead to a greater external care. Because I start caring about myself, I start eating better, I start seeing how the world is around me, and I start to take different actions in relation to the world, or perhaps the eco-critical concerns might lead me to engage with a different way of embodiment. So there's two different paths she describes. Of course, there's always the paradox of living in toxic urban environments for a lot of us, which we need to kind of communicate with and negotiate with. Practitioner Jamie McHugh, he comes from the animal helper practice. He talks about a process called embodying nature, where he runs processes which are sensory motor encounters with ecosystems that offer refuge. We used to call this hiking, going on holidays, and now we call this ecosomatic encounters. With the ocean, I was swimming, but woods, rivers, and meadows, and wild places. So it's all, it's quite romanticizing. But he has a practice called embodying nature, which features somatic expressive resources concerned with personal ecosystem of the self, the organism itself, the natural system of the place, ecosystem of the place, ecosystem of the group. He's got five different technologies that we use in breathing, vocalizing, making contact through touch, movement, and stillness as organic technologies, technologies of the self, as Foucault would have. And he has a five-part artistic conceptual maps how he leads people into creative practice, witnessing, making contact through touch, mirroring patterns on the outside through embodiment, becoming them, responding through voice, movement, and stillness, and then to reflect, so the actual reflection cycles, to rest and reflect. Practitioner Susan Bauer talks about process of embodying presence, the capacity to be present in response to both inner and outer worlds at the heart of ecosomatics. And she talks about, I call it transsubjectivity, to recognize that our deepest subjective perception is actually not just me, but shared, that biology, that living biology is shared with all of us. And she talks about moving towards a heartfelt stewardship of our planet as an aesthetic, and aesthetics and ethics. So here's an example of my good friend Simon Whited, a walking artist who lives in Wales, works in Wales, and on his website he says, you know, his aims are to connect humanity with nature, that's part of his ethos, to enliven participation. Many of the works that I've been looking at, they're about participation on a physical and poetic level, embracing the possibilities of technology as a bridge towards that. And he uses walks as maneuvers with clear strategies resulting in live performance or through various means of live and recorded media. He currently works on a series of works that he calls Studies from Maynard in a little village in West Wales where he lives. And he talks about his concern with primary physical engagement with land and the qualities of season, people in place, the studio and context of presentation exists outside of the usual art institutions. He works in the countryside, he works in a little village, in a little studio there, but also outside a lot. The interface directly with lived and sensory experience, usually involving the process of walking, journeying through which an audience may participate as witnesses. He talks about the body, an ecological paradigm in relation to its environment are the basis from which he works and realizes a series of propositions and experiences shared directly or indirectly with embodiments. Here's an example, a piece in collaboration with guerrilla gardener Richard Reynolds, seeding event in urban context, Mobile Meadow, at Shimon Davis Studios. There's a nice kind of website which you can look at, your own leisure, 2014. There's me standing there participating with my big shoulders, small bottom. Now it's the other way around. It changes when your hormonal level changes with age. Male menopause. So flowered seedling will be used in June 4, 2014 to create Mobile Meadow with the participation of over 100 people over several days, local people in urban environment, the wonderfully gentrified Elephant Castle, where you wouldn't want to go, it's too smelly, you get stabbed, you get killed, and now it's all beautiful coffee shops and beers and I worked a lot with Simon and Wright and Rosemary Lee. I worked with, for many years, artist Rosemary Lee, and they are still collaborating. Rosemary Lee worked with Simon on a piece between 2014-17, The Calling Tree, as an act of reclamation and activism to encourage us to look up. Simple as that. And be attentive to ourselves and our environment. Reframing our relationship with the natural world, the tree acts as a catalyst to bring people together, celebrating the rich diversity of the area. This was done in Tottenham and in all sorts of various areas where we have people climbing on trees and calling out of trees. Here's one of the tree callers, tree huggers we used to call them. And there's an upside down tree caller in the project. And they've worked with conservationists or with people, just tree specialists, to make sure there's no damage done. Also worked with a woman called Helen Spackman for many years. We used to sit in the same office at London Met, and it was quite a chaotic, interesting experience. But Helen now lives in Italy, and she works a lot with a guy called Manuel Basson. Manuel Basson is a leading photographer and filmmaker in the live art era. He does photo performances, and they do what they call document performances. Looking at abject spaces, Helen Spackman comes from a very strong feminist background. She looks at queering the female body. In this project, which she did over several years, called Contaminare, she is making a case what she calls for bewilderment. Case for bewilderment as a creative strategy that might effectively subvert anthropocentric representation, so that is obviously phallocentric, of the sex, body, and nature. So she made a series of photo performances where being wild, the wild being is displayed in urban spaces on the one hand, so there are these photos of her in odd situations, in odd spaces, but she also worked a lot out in quite polluted areas in southern Italy, in Salento. This is in an area of an old quarry, manganese quarry, where she works with the idea of merging rather than imposing herself on the landscape of an artist. Also a process I've been working on a lot, and I've discussed that a lot with her, this kind of merging as a strategy. There's a film there, I'll skip that straight away. Here's another image by Manuel Vasson. So what might that mean, this kind of merging and with landscape? What does landscape mean today? This is landscape. This is 2010, it's not 2018, so we know what that landscape looks like now. Important person, last person I want to talk about here is Rosalind Crisp. Rosalind Crisp is an Australian choreographer, leading Australian contemporary choreographer, who worked in Paris for a long time, in studios, choreographic practice, choreographic improvisations, has a whole pedagogy set up, went back to Australia, worked also with an organization, Critical Path, who I've worked with recently in Sydney, and she went back home to rural southwestern Australia, and this is kind of part of it. And she developed these she gave up kind of the studio-based practice and she developed these dirt projects, dance in regional disaster zones. Dance in Dirt is an ongoing project with artists and ecologists practicing in regional Australia beyond representation, mimicry. How can dance develop a form that enacts both radical dance and radical politics? How do we develop a process and language for dance that seeks to explore, embody, understand, and connect to unfolding environmental devastation? And how is this relevant to people in all places from all walks of life? So dancers can think, actually. Often they say, dancers can't think, they're just putting their toes all the time. So it's a growing culture of dance artists concerned with the changing world. There's me in 1980. It's me, I didn't have a tummy. I just thought, how did I start with this kind of somatic stuff? I was working on sensory sculptures, looking at creating these feedback sculptures where I put limbs in, which then would feed back these rubberized paper sculpture, which feed back my own body heat. And I was interested in moving away from the visual into bodily sensation and body shape.
Exactly.
It's me. So this me with mullet in 1980, doing these kind of strange photo performances when I studied art and went into kind of body art. Yeah. Here's another piece, 1983, Cycles. I was very much interested in circles and cycles. This was made in Coventry and in Newcastle at one time. And me walking for an hour and kind of gently treading down the grass in a circle as a landmark and allowing the grass to go back. So looking at kind of how there's a cycle of kind of environmental landmarking that then recovers in a circle. And this was also done in Coventry, and this was taken as me walking, and this the circle stayed for 3 months actually. And I had a fantastic encounter with someone who saw me walking who thought he was mad. We were on a bus to Newcastle upon Tyne. 1985, I met her. The woman said, I saw this guy then, he was walking for an hour, and the whole day he was walking. And the crazy guy, in the end, she decided to split up from her boyfriend after talking about this kind of stuff for me. She wanted to change her life. So, early starts, but it worked a lot in theatre with kind of embedding a bodiness, embodiment in kind of stage environments. I've worked a lot for 20 years with the director Julia Pascal, who I did movement and design installations. So here a piece, the Dibok, a Holocaust piece, where we really worked with the kind of the way we use objects in relationship to bodiness and movement, and also spaces for people to move in and to construct worlds in. Here's another piece I made as a final piece for Ross Bruford College or Bruford University in 2001, called Dora Experiments, talking about the stories from concentration camp Dora Mittelbau in Germany, where I went with my mum to visit the crematorium and other spaces, and we used again these kind of spaces, these body-mind environment unities, projected environments to create theatre. In 2003, I made a piece together with a choreographer called Annette Walter, Urbane Rituale, a kind of reclaiming of a football stadium, 150 performers, and a collaboration between Tanz Initiative, Hamburg Retina Dance Company, St. Pauli Football Club, Artifact Architects, Hamburg University, Neil Restaurant, and diverse range of community groups, choreographer direction by me and Annette Walter, really re-inhabiting, re-embodying, and reimagining urban spaces, dominant, patriarchal, violent spaces, a football stadium. How can we reclaim that in through movement? So bringing a lot of women who do quiet, slow motion rituals in the middle of the stadium. Allowing the football hooligans, the hooligan club, to do their choreography. That's their choreography. It's not environmentally friendly, I must admit. There's smoke choreography involved. And bringing different communities together, also doing small, kind of very strange action-based installations. And there was a man with a dog in the middle of the football piece. A man who walks his dog across the whole football pitch, accompanied by the football him double speed. You'll never walk alone. Sometimes stroking the dog who sniffs his way across the lawn. These images are complex, unforgettable. In fact, it is always the simple images which strike us. A logistic masterpiece, it was crazy. Yeah. So there were people of different ages, different, there was an asylum seeker choir there, there was an old people's tango club, a girls' football club involved, professional dancers. At the end, everyone was joining. At the end, everyone was embodying that holy grail, that capitalist, male, patriarchal vessel for sweat, testosterone, and aggressive behavior. Organized behavior became reimagined, re-embodied. Here's another strategy. I've been involved in kind of films. Beach Party Animal is just running in Paris at the moment, 2011. Guerrilla performance work out on Brighton Beach, a hidden camera very far away, in between the unsuspecting bathing people, performing the abject body, overweight in women's tanga, with dribbling along a public filth in on the beach as filmed from far apart with a big lens, and I lent my beautiful body to that. Another short project, 2012, we're looking at embodiment and entanglement with the environment, working with people with disabilities and non-disabilities, also with my brother, a design professor, looking at this disability arts inquiries, how do we use these somatic and space, architectural and space, environmental strategies to create work with that's accessible. The last project I'm going to talk about briefly is a project called The Secret Listeners, a guided tour, Heritage Lottery funded guided tour, looking at World War II hidden histories at Trent Park. I directed it with 35 performers, predominantly four children of Holocaust survivors. So we're looking again at social histories in public spaces, often very enclosed spaces we use. We access difficult spaces. We looked at space from different perspectives. This woman was mic'd, her shoes were mic'd, metal shoes on the glass roof. It was then transmitted into the basement through 3D sound, all sorts of interesting strategies there. And very close proximity storytelling with an audience who assembles in non-theatrical spaces, making sense of that site. So to conclude this, I want to introduce you just to this project, Moving Beyond. I didn't really know what I was doing. I was running these workshops, Moving Beyond, between 2008 and 2013 in Sicily, in the middle of Sicily, in Mafia land, and Idona, in an abandoned church which was reconstructed and turned into an empty space. We put a dance floor. And so the questions there were, was how can these somatic informed processes that I know, how can they become a shared inquiry to enable participants to co-create a decentered self as a radical process of a body reimagining? I put that down for a conference once. So trying to be clever. So here's the space, we put the dance floor down, beautiful, and we spent several summers there. And this is a bit of the landscape. It's too hot. The middle of Italy, it's dry, it's vast. So we use process of the Feldenkrais method, this going inside the somatic processes to get into the self-reflectivity, to defamiliarize our way of perceiving ourselves, and to create a critical self-activation. And we use touch interaction, partnering work through process called contact improvisation to engage with the other organism. we then took this quality of being out into the environment where we worked through observation, exploration, and immersion, this merging processes and responding and interacting with environments to create performance. And we start with the affective self, with the embodied affective self that can feel, scream, and expands out. We activate the person. We connect the person through touch. We engage with this eroding landscape, this eroding dry landscape. And it was amazing, Antonio Bonomola, one of my favorite people, he's a band manager who's now only 0.5 band manager and plays in a band and is very, very crazy. He's a wonderful storyteller and singer. And he talks about, I remember how deeply the daily study in nature touched me when we were in Idona. The first day, my group was watching a place, a simple place in nature, nothing special. It suddenly became a story by spending time there. Lot of work through touch, through direct experience. I think the creation process was easy because every day we were cleaning our body and mind through Feldenkrais and contact improvisation, an experience of clinging to the truth, full of good human beings, the band manager. And they were all band managers, they were lawyers, biologists, and judges, school teachers. They were out in the bare landscape, crawling up there, making work. They were performing, then they're up there. The cows were coming from the left suddenly. They were waving with these big sticks, interacting with the animals. And coming down the hill. And then the local farmer who came to watch it, he said, just, you honored our land. You honored our land troops. No one wants this land. It's nothing. It's dead. Noisy people, really noisy, Sicilian, and they're messy, just doing crazy things with objects, large things, climbing up extraordinary situations. So re-embodying, re-inhabiting, re-testing, trying out, seeing the world through different ways of doing things. At the same time, I was running workshops in the winter, in Fiumefreddo, a very different environment, at the bottom of the Etna. Engaging with, immersing yourself in the fruit orchards. Playing with simple phenomena like shadow, reflection, moistness. Pina Bauschpies, Nelken in the middle of a fruit orchard and dynamic interaction with empty agricultural spaces. And out of all this, a collective emerged called Dance Attack. And they made work between 2010 and in Catania, Palermo, and Siracusa. And my friend Stefania Milazzo called, we made this to demonstrate against consumerism. All these people from this workshop made their own company and against policymaking through dance and performance. So they did things like this. Here they made a piece called Hyperflop. This big company called Hyperflop. So Hyper Co-op in Italy, big supermarket. So they made these pieces in supermarkets and in front of supermarkets, striptease pieces, and where they just jump, get undressed and they throw things away, and they're in the middle of people don't know what on earth is all this, what they're doing. We're doing this kind of urban intervention. He's the bank manager now. In his little underpants. There's no way back now. I've embodied this now. And then, of course, they do standing and falling, typical strategies, and playing kind of as a Mickey Mouse in the back, playing traditional Sicilian music, demonstrating against consumerism. But didn't stop there. They then made pieces like Fiori nel Traffico, in Catania 2011, urban performance intervention against pollution. So we were handing out flowers in their little gas masks to cars in traffic jams, falling down, melting down, sinking down, and they were even doing contact improvisation on police cars. So there was this kind of, when I talk about somatic activism, hopefully that is a kind of example of people who have taken action, school teachers, lawyers, biologists, bank managers, they are not professional people. One, the final piece they made, one final piece, was a collaboration with Le Giardiniere d'Utro at Piazza San Cristoforo. So a collective, a collaboration with a gardening collective, guerrilla gardening collective, and they rewilded a public square which had turned into a parking space. So they hacked it open, they re-choreographed this, they re-embodied this, they planted something there, they reopened the urban world into a playground in the end, and then this becomes a playground. He was a policeman. So, sustain your place. So here's the band manager again, Antonio Bonomolo. If you want to hear him play the accordion and the trumpet, you go onto the YouTube videos. You know, I experienced how easy and deep the site-specific can be, representing something you want to tell through moving your body, moving a group of bodies as we are in society. We're nearly there. Stefania Milazzo then really got, she is a biologist to turn filmmaker, she really got kind of fired up to make work in Sicily. She developed something that she I would call a contemporary disorientation of traditional rituals as a subversive hijacking of religious protocols. This project, Nutuk Tatere, was a project that refers to women in 1800s during the religious feast of Santa Agata. We were even allowed to leave the house alone with our brothers, fathers, and husbands, as sometimes in Sicily women are. And traditionally, these women were dressed in black. They dressed them in white, and they just really climbed all over. They just went to these big processions, and they just hijacked these religious Catholic processions. We got inspired by this tradition and represented it to celebrate the freedom of women. And this picture for me is kind of pretty much, this is quite stunning. There's this woman in white who should be in black, who shouldn't even be there, with a kind of very, very dark male figure there in a public space, staring at her, not quite at her. Here's another piece by Stefania, wenn Konsum zur Notwendigkeit wird, when consumption becomes a necessity, again, a guided tour, an eyes-closed tour with shopping bags overhead in Primark, and then a clothing gathering ritual where they just went in blindfolded and just grabbed clothing as kind of disrupting anarchic experience. And one of the last pieces she made, 2014, a piece about asylum and refugee crisis called Human Waste. And through that I worked with her on a project which is finishes this now, called Punti di Fuga. And Milazzo talks about the workshop opened my mind and changed my entire life approach. Thanks to the Feldenkrais method, I became aware of what was around me. Good Lord, it's an introspective process, looking inside. I became aware of what was around me, and I tried to communicate in a performative way. So this led to her running a project called Punti di Fuga, Fluchtpunkt Intercultural Artistic Project with citizens of Dresden. Dresden is the center of the Pegida movement, patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of Europe. The massive demonstrations every Monday. She was really astonished about this. So we ran a series of performance projects with citizens of Dresden and with people with refugee backgrounds. We invited his was working with an Iranian choreographer who kind of fled Iran, Afshin Garafin. He made a piece called workshop called Dancing Hearts, Escaping Bodies with them, with the group. I worked with a workshop called Nature and Movement as a Means of Communication. And in this workshop, we worked for 3 days looking at topics of home, memories, desires, hopes, leaving, arriving, letting go, staying behind, movement, spatial interaction and touch, storytelling, shared immersion in nature as tools for shared artistic practice and collaborative cultural exchange. there are a few pictures of people just meeting, touching, we're done now. Testing the boundaries, pulling things apart, opening out, and again getting the affective self, the affected self activated, screaming, shouting, laughing, being someone. Internalizing, young Syrian person just kind of opening into this space, communicating, connecting, merging with other people. Disorienting. I playfully discovered one of the people brought my body and touched by other human beings in new ways. Small community, a utopia of a better world, some of them said. And there were quite extraordinary scenes coming up, scenes of helplessness, of support, of quite extraordinary stories. And this young man said, "Look, I don't understand what we're doing. This is very different from the way we normally behave with each other in the outside world." I didn't really know what to say, and I thought, actually, that's just what it's all about, isn't it? To practice new ways of interaction, interacting with the world. So we took this outside, these processes, these aware processes. This is the last slide. Home is not a place, but a feeling of trust, one of the participants said. Being myself and surrounded by supportive people, this was a wonderful experience. I had a lot of fun. I can now discover my home, where I come from, country, with new eyes. For me, what was very special was to return this project. We made a DVD, made a documentary with this project, and this project was then screened for 1 week at the 2016 documentary festival in Dresden, film festival, on the site of the Pegida demonstrations at the Neumarkt, where the 10,000 racist people assemble. This was shown, this film, this project. So we brought this as a cycle back. A different way of being was publicized through the use of media in a heavily racialized space and nasty space. That's it. Thank you very much.